That's the visible church. That's what we see today. That's where we're, what's where we are, right? You see, the universal church, it focuses on our relationship to the Lord and the kingdom aspect of God's work. Okay, and I believe we're in that time right now where God wants us to spend time with Him. Right? Right now. Right? He's given us several weeks where this thing is not looking well, you know, but He's given us some time to just dive into who He is and to spend that time with Him. Right? You see, the key to church being the church in the universal sense is for every believer to be in harmony with the Lord of the church. Right? I feel the Spirit speaking about awakening, a shaking, a time of Sabbath to get back to the body. Right? You know, so it's in this time we need to stay connected to the body of Jesus. We need to stay in the Word. Stay in prayer. Right? Because we are the church. You are the church. And the local church, the visible church, and this is where we're going to focus a bit today, right? We're going to focus here because, you know what? We're scattered like sheep at this time. We have an 8-foot distance between each of us, and some of us are here and here. And God's teaching us that we still need to reach out as a local church to each other. You see, because our local church focuses on our relationship to our brothers and sisters in Christ, right? And the key to the church, being the church, is that for believers to be in harmony with other believers. Mm-hmm. Amen? Yeah. Right? Unity is the key to the presence of the Lord in the church, not divisiveness. Right? Unity is the key to the power of the church. So how we worship here today, we're still a unified body. We're just separated. Right? So John 17, 22 and 23 says this, "Again I say to you, that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven." Unity is the key to the witness and testimony of the church. Right? Matthew 16, 18 says this, "And the glory to which you gave me, I have given them, that they may be one, just as we are one, I in them and you in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them as you have loved me." Unity is the key to fulfilling destiny of the church. And I want to just read this to you because this is the what God's giving us. Jesus gives us this, the church, according to what He says. So Matthew 18, 15 and 20. Right? And we take for granted so many things, but when we listen to this word, right? "If another believer sins against you, go privately and point out the offense. If the other person listens and confesses it, you've won that person back. But if you're unsuccessful, take one or two others with you and go back again, so that everything you say may be confirmed by two or three witnesses. If the person still refuses to listen, take your case to the church. Then if he or she won't accept the church's decision, treat that person as a pagan or a corrupt tax collector. I tell you the truth, whatever you forbid on earth will be forbidden in heaven, and whatever you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven." Right? "I also tell you this, if two of you agree here on earth concerning anything you ask, my Father in heaven will do it for you. For where two or three gather together as many followers, I am among them." So I'm going to extract some stuff out of here, some truths out of that. And I think it's really cool, actually. Look. The local church is comprised and composed of brothers and sisters, right? That means that it was meant to be a family setting. It was meant to be a place of close relationship. Right? And it's to be a place of belonging. And you guys, I know that this is really difficult because as a body of believers, we love fellowshipping. Right? We do. And so some of us, it really feels strained. Okay? Because we do. We really love fellowshipping with one another. But it's not just a Sunday we are to do that. It's to be every day. Right? You see, the local church, it's not perfect either. Right? There's going to be conflicts for people. Right? And there's going to be difficulties to work through until Jesus comes. You see, we're to succeed as the church, and we must be committed to the conflict resolution and working through the process. Is this easy? No. But we can be a messy church with grace.
Amen.
Right? God's provided a means whereby those conflicts can be resolved.
Yes.
Right? The local church is a place of discipline, as it says in verse 16 and 17. It's not a loose-knit group having no responsibility or accountability, right, to each other. It's a place where we get involved in each other's life, but we need permission. Right? It's a place where sin is confronted and discipline is administered. And sometimes this gets painful, but it is necessary. You see, the local church is defined, you know, is a defined body of believers, as it says in verse 17. It's a place where you know, where you're known to be a part of. It's a place which you can be expelled from. Right? You're either a part of the local church or you're not a part of the local church by being contributors and distributors, not consumers and connoisseurs. Verse 18, the local church is a channel of God's authority. You guys, we have authority as a church, right? The authority of God, of heaven, is vested in the local church, each one here, right? God supports the disciplining actions of the church, right? We're to be disciplined by the church is to be disciplined by Christ. Guys, we're given authority over God's kingdom in this place and in this city. Right? And all of those places that God places us. You see, we're also a local church. Verse 19 is a place of unity and agreement. Right? It's the power. It's dependent on it. Right? The presence of God confirms it. You see, the local church is to be a place of fellowship and faith and prayer. Right? There's a gathering together. It's a corporate asking of God. There's a corporate expectation for God to act. You guys, verse 20, listen. The local church is a place where Christ promises to dwell. It's the habitation of God by the Spirit. It's the manifestation of God's presence that's unique to the gathering of God's people. And then the local church, right, is a gathering identified with the name of Christ. It carries the authority of His name, and it is His. We're to be His representative of that given locally where we are. You see, one person cannot make up a local church. The local church is to be a place of order. And until the church is completed, there's going to be a great need for love, patience, and a lot of forgiveness. You know, you're reminded, Peter came up to Jesus and he said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me? And I forgive him. Up to seven times, Jesus said. I do not say to you up to seven times, but up to 70 times seven. And these are some prerequisites of the local church, which is the means by which the purposes of God will become a reality. Listen, Ephesians 4, 1 to 16 says this. Therefore, I, a prisoner, so this is Paul writing this, for serving the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of your calling. For you have been called by God. Always be humble and gentle. Be patient with each other, making allowances for each other's faults because of your love. Make every effort to keep yourself unified in the Spirit, binding yourselves together with peace. For there's one body and one spirit, just as you've been called to one glorious hope in the future. There is one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all, in all, and living through all. However, he's given each one of us a special gift through the generosity of Christ. This is why the scriptures say, when he ascended to the heights, he led a crowd of captives and gave his gift to people. Notice that it says he ascended. This clearly means that Christ also descended to the lowly world. And the same one who descended is the one who ascended higher than all the heavens, so that he might fill the entire universe with himself. Now these are the gifts Christ gave to the church: the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and the teachers, and their responsibility is to equip God's people to do his work and build up the church, the body of Christ. This will continue until we come to such unity in our faith and knowledge of God's Son that we'll be mature in the Lord, measuring up to the full and complete standard of Christ. Then we will no longer be immature like children. We won't be tossed around, blown about by every wind and new teaching. We will not be influenced when people try to trick us with lies, so clever they sound like the truth. Instead, we will speak the truth in love, growing in every way more and more like Christ, who is the head of his body, the church. He makes the whole body fit perfectly together, and each part does its own special work. It helps the other parts grow so that the whole body is healthy and growing and full of love. See, this church, it's a place where you're known to be a part. Right? It's a place. Where am I? Sorry. Paul states in prerequisite the heart attitudes we must have: humility. Humility, gentleness, patience, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Okay, Paul states the reason for our efforts, verse 4 and 6. There's one body, one Spirit, only one hope, only one Lord, only one faith, only one baptism. There's only one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. Paul states the means by which God will perfect the church, 7 through 12, is the grace of God working in each person. The leadership ministries working to equip the saints for the works of the service. The saints using their gifts to build up the body of Christ. You guys are the saints. We are the church. We are the saints. If you're a Christian, you are a saint. Look, Paul states the goal towards which we are moving. That's 13 to 60. A church that experiences unity of faith. A church that has an intimate relationship with Christ. A church that represents Christ completely. A church that is prophetic, leading society on a pure path. And a sure path, right? A church that matures into Christ's character. A church where every member knows their part and does their part. Because there's no job below us. This is where we learn what a servant is, really. A servant means that there's a master. A servant means humility and humbleness. A servant means what Jesus came as. He came to serve. A servant means that you serve the needs of others. You know, servants are given natural gifts, talents, and abilities, and gifts of the Spirit. Right? We're going to come back to this. We're going to go back into this into another part of the sermon. Future. So we're going to go dive into that a bit more. Even servant evangelism, to just go out and share the gospel. 1 Peter 4:10 and 11. God has given each of you a gift from his great variety of spiritual gifts. Use them well to serve one another. Do you have the gift of speaking? Then speak as though God himself were speaking through you. Do you have the gift of helping others? Then do it with all the strength and energy that God supplies. Then everything you do will bring glory to God through Jesus Christ. And all glory and power to him forever and ever. Amen. Look, 2 Corinthians 8:19. This one comes from NIV. What is more, he was chosen by the churches to accompany us. We carry the offering, which we administer in order to honor the Lord himself and to show our eagerness to help. God especially enjoys watching us use our talents and abilities that he's given us. He loves it, right? God intentionally gifted us different for his enjoyment. You know, these might be include like math, mechanics, music, athleticism, analytics, artistic, or a thousand other things. You see, scripture tells us he shaped us, each person in turn, and now he watches everything we do. We're not to squander our gifts. They're given to us. Just like if you have a son or daughter, what, you know, that was amazing at hockey or dance, right? We take joy and delight in them, right? We're proud. We're happy to see them dancing and receiving accolades for their gifts. I want to take a bit of a turn. How often do we put churches in a nice box? Right? Or even put church ministries on a pedestal? Maybe even idolize these things. I want you to think about that, because often we do that. And I know I have at times. You know, the higher you put something up, the harder it is to reach. And the farther it comes crashing down. I think God's in a time right now where he's changing what church looks like, because there's been idolatry in our church for church ministries. And our churches, each one of us, oh, my church is doing this, and this church is doing this, and finger pointing from church to church. I think he's putting our eyes back to where it's supposed to be, on who he is. So I think he's shaking up the churches. He's shaking up the churches, right. Christians and even non-believers,
yes.
Right? To see with different eyes.
Yes.
You know, this is the year of clear vision, you know, and James, you know, he mentioned that. But, you know, maybe it wasn't as clear as we thought, because we're seeing with our eyes. God gives us a cool prescription to see even clearer. Maybe that's our problem today, what's going on. We need to see through the eyes of Jesus for that true and total clarity. Amen? Right? We need to put on the Jesus glasses to get the 2020 perspective. We also need to be realistic in our expectations of what church is. Right? We must passionately love the church in spite of its imperfections. You know, other believers are going to let us down and disappoint you, but you know what? That's no excuse to stop fellowshipping with them. They are our family, even when they don't act like it. Right? And we can't just walk out on them. Ephesians 4:2 says, be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. We become disappointed with the church due to these possible outcomes, right? Conflict, hurt, neglect, hypocrisy, legalism, pettiness, and other sins. And there's so much finger-pointing in churches today as to what's going on. You see, I think we needed to have a little bit of a break to just realize how much we love each other in this church. How separated we are, that we need each other. we take for granted our families, our church family. You know, the church is made up of sinners. And you guys maybe that are listening that haven't stepped in the church, I hate to break it to you, but the church is made of sinners.
Yeah, that's right.
We're not holier than thou people. We are sinners. And because we're sinners, we hurt each other intentionally or unintentionally. You know, instead of leaving the church, we need to stay and work it out. Because God loves to reconcile, and we need reconciliation. And that builds a stronger character and a deeper fellowship with one another. You know, a family that goes through hardships pulls them closer. Church. I love our churches and our community. Right? You know, the sooner we give up on the illusion that a church must be perfect for in order for us to love it, the sooner we're going to quit pretending and start admitting that we're all imperfect and we need God's grace.
Right.
You know, we put a sign out that says no perfect people need apply. This is a place only for those who admit that they're sinners, need grace, and want to grow. You see, the universal church represents two pieces of a plank. This is the universal church, the invisible church, which is Godward, up and down. And you see, the horizontal church is our local church. And that's manward. Because Jesus died for both. He died for both. He died to reconcile man to God and to bring harmony and peace. Between all men. The cross is the key to both the universal and local church. Listen, John 16, 32 and 33. Behold, the hour is coming. Indeed, it has come, when you will be scattered, each in his own home, and will leave me alone. Yet I am not alone, for your Father is with me. And I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. And in the world, you will have tribulation. But take heart. I have overcome the world. I'm going to read you a piece of scripture from here. And I'm going to just close in prayer. I want you to listen to the scripture carefully, because you want to see Jesus' heart is crying out in this piece of scripture. John 17. I thank my lovely wife for finding this today. Mm-hmm. She's come across it, and it speaks volumes to today. John 17, 17 to